So what I'm going to be talking about in this lecture is some of the interesting phenomena which occur when you basically try to take a bulk superconductor and pare it down to as small an element as possible, in particular a very thin nanowire. Now, I don't think I realized when I volunteered to talk about this subject what an enormous literature on it there is, and in fact I shan't be able to cover by any means the whole subject in this lecture. I know that some of you are in fact explicitly very interested in this, and I hope to be able to do a little more reading and discussion on it, but let me try to give you at least a sort of rough overview of what the state of play is in this general area. Here are some references. Lango and Amagarkar, a classic reference on phase slips in more or less bulk superconducting wires. Scotch, Paul Beasley and Tinkham introduced the idea of phase slip centers, very important in practice. My colleague Alexei Bezradin, experimental review in 2008. This is a theory review. And this is a very recent paper, again by the Bezradin group, where they've done some very interesting experiments where they deliberately shunted these nanowires. But again, I shan't be able to cover all the details of that in this lecture. So, at least as far as we know, if we, for the moment, just for the purposes of this lecture, define superconductivity in terms of one of its basic manifestations, that is the apparently dissipationless supercurrents, metastable supercurrents, then it appears to be almost infinitely metastable in bulk three-dimensional metals in zero magnetic field. I mean, people have There have been some famous demonstration experiments where people actually flew a superconducting coil across the North Sea for a demonstration and so forth, and it still was perfectly circulating current. A lower limit on the decay of the supercurrent under normal conditions is something like 10 to the 15 years, so much greater than the age of the universe. So in bulk three dimensions, metals in zero magnetic field, it does appear to be essentially infinitely metastable. Now, one does know that if you change these conditions somewhat, then it's not necessarily quite so metastable. Even in three dimensions, if you take a type 2 superconductor, put a large magnetic flux on it so that you punch through vortices, then the vortices may be somewhat free to move, and that will then tend to destroy the supercurrent. So you no longer have, strictly speaking, infinite conductivity or infinite persistence of your currents. Again, in two-dimensional films, we believe that the sort of Kostelitz-Thouless type of behavior, again, you don't always get infinite conductivity there. So let's try to push this even further. Suppose that we take a material which in three-dimensional bulk state is essentially a perfect superconductor, and we just try to reduce the dimensions. In particular, let's try to make ultra-thin nanowires and see what happens there. Okay, so these experiments really go back to something like the early 1970s, and in those days at least, they were done on whiskers of, say, aluminum, tin, whatever, which were typically of a diameter of the order, D, I always use D for the diameter of the wire, typically about the order of 0.5 microns, so by modern standards, pretty thick still. Nowadays, we can actually go down to something like 10 nanometers. That's been done by growing aluminum on a sort of little ridge of indium phosphate. You can even go down to dimensions smaller than that. It's a very interesting technique which was pioneered by Alexei Bezradin. The way this works is that you take a silicon nitride substrate, you cut out or etch out a trench in it, and then you take a very thin natural wire and lay it across there. And you might, for example, use carbon nanotubes, or you might even more ambitiously use DNA molecules. And Alexei has actually used DNA molecules to do this. So far, you haven't got yourself a superconductor, because neither of these are intrinsically superconducting. However, what you can now do is to sputter molybdenum germanium alloy on top of this. And typically, because of the geometry of the experiment, what you end up with is a thin molybdenum germanium film coating the surface of the silicon nitride here. But you also end up with a sort of tube of molybdenum coating, surrounding or coating the nanotube or DNA molecule. So now you have a very, very, very narrow, thin wire, which is apart from the central bit, which is still your DNA or whatever, the rest of it really is a very thin wire of molybdenum germanium. Can be as thin as 4 nanometers in some cases, typical lengths of the order of 40 to 500 nanometers. Beyond that, it becomes a little difficult to get them stable and so forth. Now, what do we know about molybdenum germanium? This is superconducting both in, I guess it does form a crystalline form if you anneal it sufficiently, but it's usually an alloy form in bulk with a TC of the order of 7.4K, about 7.4K, quite high. It's very amorphous, typical mean free paths of the order of the interatomic spacing of a few angstroms. Typical resistivity, something like this. The London penetration depth, again, it's going to depend on whether it's in crystalline or amorphous form, because remember that typically if you take a crystalline superconductor with a given London penetration depth and start putting a whole lot of dirt in it or start disordering it, then the effect is to increase the London penetration depth. So it's a few thousand angstroms. The in pure crystalline molygermanium, the pair radius is about 10 to the 4 angstroms. But remember that in a dirty material, the actual pair Cooper pair radius is reduced by this factor here. So it's only of the order of a few hundred angstroms. Nevertheless, in most of these, in most samples, we're going to be talking about the diameter of the wire is actually, it's certainly small compared to the London penetration depth, usually also small compared to the effective Cooper pair radius. So it really is, from all points of view, an essentially one-dimensional system. And remember, incidentally, there's one thing that people tend to forget. Suppose that I simply take a bulk, three-dimensional superconductor, and simply shrink its dimensions down until the actual size of the grain I'm considering is smaller than the Cooper pair radius. Okay? Now, does that mean that it ceases to be superconducting? Well, apparently not. I mean, at least it's still, well, let's say this. Its thermodynamic properties still seem pretty much like the bulk. So the system doesn't really seem to care whether the dimensions are large or small compared to the Cooper pair radius, which at first sight is a little surprising, but at least that seems to be the case. So anyway, one can say that effectively, under these cases, presumably one can neglect any substantial effect of the transverse dimension. That is, things are more or less presumably homogeneous across the cross-section of the wire. Okay, so how do the experiments go? Well, of course, it's usually rather difficult to put your leads on at the ends of the wire itself. So what you're typically doing is to measure your current and voltage between the far edges or some point on the molygermanium film here. So the most basic experiment, we'll leave out this bit here, We have the original nanowire here, and you just measure the DC resistance as a function of temperature and as a function of the wire parameters. And most of the experiments, at least until quite recently, have been of that general nature. But you can do also various other fancier things. You can measure the nonlinear IV characteristics as a function of temperature. And in particular, you can measure the hysteresis, if there is any, in these experiments. You can apply microwave power and see how it affects the current voltage characteristics. And even you can, as has been done recently by the Lazaridis group, you can deliberately shunt your wire by a normal resistance here. That turns out to be quite an interesting thing to try to do. However, there is one ubiquitous complication in all these molecular templated nanowires, which is simply the effect of heating. The moment your current exceeds the bulk critical current density, then almost certainly you're going to go into the normal state. I mean, it may happen before that, but it's certainly going to happen at that point. So the moment you exceed the critical current, you've got to worry a lot about heating, because remember, you've got this wire is more or less in vacuum here. Thermal transport away from it is very difficult out of the sides, in fact almost non-existent, so the heat's got to be conducted out of the ends of the wire. And so that's an important factor in interpreting the actual experimental data. And this dual heating may play a role even if the wire remains mainly in the superconducting state. And in fact, I have a student right now who's working on some of these effects, and he believes that in quite a few of these experiments, the dominant effect may have simply been this rather boring classical heating effect. Okay, let's just sort of briefly try to overview the experimental results before we go on to talk about the theory behind their interpretation. What about the temperature dependence of the DC resistivity? Well, there does seem to be a rather clear-cut situation for short homogeneous wires. That means, when I say homogeneous, I mean homogeneous in cross-section. They can do, I don't know exactly how they do this, I think it's probably scanning tunneling microscopy. They can actually try to assess how uniform these wires are, and Alexei Bezradin at least believes that most of his DNA templated wires really are pretty homogeneous in cross-section, and things do appear to be consistent with that view. So if we have these short homogeneous wires, then what we typically find is that when we do the actual measurement, remember we are measuring the resistance not just of the wire but also of the film which is in series with it. So what we find is that at the TC of bulk monogermanium, you get a drop in the resistance, and that's of course rather to be expected because presumably the bulk film has now gone superconducting, so you're not seeing that. But then you do find typically that the resistance you measure remains constant to a temperature considerably lower than the bulk TC. So, and that is somewhat sample dependent. What that means is that you can pretty legitimately define a normal resistivity or resistance, a normal resistance of the wire itself, okay, by looking at this at the constant, roughly constant resistance in this interval here. Now, when I get down to a somewhat lower temperature, 0.3 to 0.7 of TC, you may see several types of behavior. The simplest type is that it actually drops precipitously, and eventually, as you lower the temperature, it just gets to the unmeasurably small. And so we would naturally describe that as superconducting type behavior. The alternative is that it may tend to a small but non-zero value for in the limit of zero temperature, and the natural name for that is normal state behavior. That is actually not usually seen in these very short wires. It's seen in somewhat longer ones. And finally, you may actually find that as you go down in temperature, the resistance actually increases somewhat. It doesn't usually increase very dramatically, but some of you may remember that if you do rather similar experiments on very thin disordered two-dimensional films, you often find that there is that above a certain normal state resistance, the curves turn up very sharply, and you get genuinely insulating behavior at zero temperature. That doesn't appear to happen, or at least not very, very dramatically, for these nanowires, but you do get still an increase. So you can, and you can actually ask the obvious question: is there a particular value of the normal state resistance at which the crossover from superconducting-like behavior to insulating-type behavior occurs? And the answer is yes, there does appear to be, and very interestingly, it appears to be at least close to the famous quantum unit of resistance, h over 4 e squared, about 6.5 kiloohms. Now, if you go to longer or less homogeneous wires, then you find that the results are more complicated, and in particular, in these longer wires, you do see a range of normal type behavior. That is, so let's just take a look at the graphs here. Yeah. So these would be the three types of behavior. Typically, here's superconducting behavior, the resistance diving down to an unmeasurably small value. Insulating type behavior, increasing, but not dramatically so. And normal type behavior, and you can have all sorts of normal type behavior, like so. So the general picture is actually quite complicated, and does appear to depend quite substantially on the parameters of the wire. One of the interesting questions which doesn't seem to be totally resolved, although there's been a lot of work on it in these wires, is what happens a function of resistance per unit length or of the total resistance of the wire? I mean, a priori, it could presumably be either. One doesn't really know. If anything, the picture which is emerging seems to be that it's probably more a function of the total resistance, but again, one's not entirely sure. So let's go on to discuss the theory now. And I think a large influence on the development of the theory in this area has been work which is done on a much simpler system, which is a simple isolated Josephson junction. So in some sense, this is often taken to be a sort of toy model of what's going on in these nanowires. So let's first take a look at what goes on there. Suppose you have an isolated Josephson junction, and let's for the moment suppose it's the good old classical type which Josephson originally thought about, which was a tunnel oxide barrier. So you've simply got two metals which are separated by this thin oxide layer. We believe that an excellent description of the sort of at the semi-classical level of the behavior of a junction of this type are the two equations originally written down by Josephson in his 1962 paper. The first equation says that the current across the junction is simply some critical current times the sine of delta phi of t. And delta phi here is the phase drop of the Cooper pair wave function across the junction. The second Josephson equation says that, I'm sorry, this should be a delta phi dot. Well, I don't know why it's got two dots. That was my mistake, I think. It should be delta phi dot. That's 2EV divided by H bar. That, of course, is the equation which is at the basis of the use of Josephson junctions for metrology and so forth, because it relates a frequency and a voltage. So the most direct consequences of these two equations are that, first of all, if I has some constant value, if I'm imposing an external current through my leads, which is less than the critical current, then what that's going to do, according to this equation, is to fix the phase drop across the junction at this value sine to the minus 1, I over IC. And under those conditions, delta phi is fixed in time, so there's zero voltage developed across the junction. That is, of course, the standard DC Josephson effect. second point which emerges from here is that the maximum current which can actually be carried by the junction itself is the critical current, which will be some number for any particular junction. So this model in which we simply have an external current coming in through the leads and flowing through the junction, and that's all, that model will not work once I becomes greater than IC. So you've got to get somewhere else for the current to go. Okay, well, this leads to what is usually called the RSJC model. That stands for resistively shunted junction with capacitance. What we pretty up our circuit a little by putting in parallel with the junction itself some kind of capacitance, and this is not necessarily, I mean, it could be some kind of extra parallel plate capacitor we put in by hand, but it usually isn't. I mean, it's usually the actual geometrical capacitance of the junction itself, in effect, which we so far haven't taken account of. And then secondly, we put in parallel a resistor. Again, in special cases, we might actually provide that by hand, but again, normally, there'll be some characteristics of the junction itself, which will play the role of a resistor. At non-zero temperature, for example, it could be the behavior of the normal quasi-particles, which are just trying to do ordinary Geva tunneling across the junction. Even at zero temperature, very typically in these junctions, there tend to be shorts, little shorts in the edge and so forth. So typically there is something like that there. Of course, the resistance and conceivably the capacitance might themselves be temperature dependent. We don't usually worry too much about that. We usually, in applications of the model, you most commonly assume that these are constants. Well, if you combine that with the earlier equation, which is the second Josephson equation, that's this one here, and do some sort of standard electrical engineering transformations, what you find is that you now got a second order equation for the evolution of the phase drop across the junction. If we cut out these two terms, we just get back to our original result, but now we've got these extra two terms. Now, if for the moment we forget about this dissipative term here, then this is the equation which we would obtain from a Hamiltonian, which has the following form. It has a capacitance multiplying the rate of change, the time rate of change of the phase drop across the junction. Then it has a potential which is proportional to cos delta phi, and then it has this extra term minus I delta phi, which you need to get this term here. And so this is often called, for a reason you'll see in a moment, the washboard potential. It looks like, crudely, like this. So you see you have a uniform slope corresponding to the external current, and then you have this periodic potential here, which is due to the junction itself. And this is, you can visualize this problem as corresponding to the motion of a single particle in that washboard potential. The correspondence is that the phase drop across the junction becomes the coordinate of the particle. The capacitance goes over into the mass of the particle, and then this is actually to be a 1 over r. 1 over r goes over so the shunting conductance, not the resistance, the shunting conductance goes over into the friction coefficient of the particle. Now, there is one rather nasty problem here, which has caused some controversy in the literature and is still, I think, not completely resolved. And it's the following. If I was talking here, if delta phi here were a real coordinate and I had this real washboard potential, I don't exactly how I know I'd do it, but maybe if I took a crystalline lattice and put in a very strong electric field, it might look something like that. Then there'd be no particular ambiguity about the meaning of x. In other words, this position here would be quite clearly physically distinct from this position here. Now, the problem with the Josephson junction is that you're talking about the phase drop of the Cooper pair wave function, and it's not immediately obvious that when that goes through 2 pi, I've actually reached a physically different state. That's actually quite surprisingly difficult issue to work out. in the literature, you almost always find it just assumed without argument that you can treat these as physically different states, but it's not too obvious that you can. You know. So what can be the what's the typical semi-classical behaviour? So for the moment, we just imagine we're doing straightforward Newtonian mechanics, as it were, or the analogue of Newtonian mechanics with this system. Then for I less than IC, the picture looks like this. And in the absence of any kind of fluctuations, presumably if the system starts in a given well, it'll stay there. Suppose, however, that I becomes greater than IC, then the picture changes to something like this, and you now see there's no more free energy barrier, and the system can sort of roll down the potential. At least that's what it would do if it were a mechanical particle. So for, just to repeat that, essentially, if I is a constant value less than IC, then delta phi will be trapped at a constant value, zero voltage will develop across the junction. For I greater than IC, delta phi will start running down the washboard potential, and in practice, it's going to reach some terminal velocity, which will be limited by the friction, which, remember, is proportional to the shunting conductance. That means that the rate of change, the average rate of change of phi in this region, is going to be proportional to R itself. So the voltage is proportional to R. So rather surprisingly, considering this complicated system, you've got back to good old Ohm's law in some, or at least an approximate form. Here. Now, one amusing kind of experiment that one can do, and which has been done, is to imagine that you, say, start off with this situation here. You gradually turn the current up until you get to this situation. So you go from the zero voltage state now to the finite voltage state, where the system is running down and limited by the friction coefficient. But now you start gradually turning your current back down again. In other words, you try to go back from here to here. And I think it's somewhat obvious that if your friction coefficient is low enough, then the system will not immediately get retracted. It'll continue to bounce down, as it were, and it's only when you've lowered the slope to a sufficiently low value that you'll get retracted. So that's a so-called retrapping experiment, and people try to determine the retrapping critical current. That's quite an interesting issue. This retrapping will occur below the original critical current, provided that the so-called Q factor here, which is a combination of the various parameters, is greater than one. For lower values, it gets immediately retrapped. Or at least that's the theory. Okay, let's go back for a moment to the junction itself, a sort of simple unshunted junction, and ask why is the current simply given by this rather simple expression, IC sine delta phi? Why not something more complicated? Well, crudely speaking, I think we're going to look at it in the following way. Suppose we start off with zero phase drop across the physical junction. The physical junction is somewhere around here in this picture. Okay, so this is actually not correct because, this is an error in my drawing, I guess. In fact, the actual amplitude of the order parameter should decrease very, very, very strongly in this region here. But for delta phi equals zero, it stays real. Now imagine that we start cranking the relative phase across the junction up, for example, by applying a voltage. Remember that by the second Josephson equation, that's going to change the phase difference. Then, and imagine that we've cranked it up to the point where delta phi is actually equal to pi. Under those conditions, what may happen, and what is believed to happen in these simple Josephson junctions, is that the order parameter simply goes through zero in the middle of the junction here. Now it stays real, delta phi is pi, so it can stay real. It just changes sign, so it has to go through zero in the middle of the junction here. So if this is true, then once I've got beyond this point, the system no longer knows, as it were, that delta phi is say 3/4 pi rather than 1/4 pi. It looks exactly the same. So in other words, The system only knows delta phi modulo 2 pi in this case. This is what's sometimes called the non-hysteretic case. You have to be careful, though. As a matter of fact, there's an unfortunate ambiguity in the use of the term non-hysteretic as hysteretic as applied to Josephson junctions. It's also applied in a quite different context, so just watch out for that in the literature. But anyway, this is one sort of very standard type of behavior. As you crank the phase up, when you get to pi, you just get a node of your wave function in the middle of the junction. In other words, you sort of slipped a 2 pi of phase without really noticing it here. Now, that's not the only possibility. If, for example, I have a more general kind of weakening, for example, a microbridge is basically just a constriction made of the bulk material, but much, much narrower here. Under those conditions, the energy of the link itself is not negligible. So originally the order parameter did not dip as it should have in my last graph. And under these circumstances, when delta phi is cranked up to pi, it may actually be energetically advantageous for the magnitude of the order parameter to stay non-zero. In other words, instead of just going from zero to pi by just going through zero, it goes around in the Argand diagram, in the complex plane instead. And under those conditions, you can crank up the phase well beyond pi before the system starts to break down, as it were. And that means then that values of delta phi, which are different by 2 pi, are not in fact equivalent. This is the so-called hysteretic case. Now, both of these situations may apply in the kind of context where we're going to be thinking about it in thin nanowires, for example. So it's important to realize that there is a difference there. We know that in the limit of a very strong microbridge, basically it's going to just act as bulk. So that under those conditions, the maximum current must be limited by the bulk critical current density. Now, we know that all superconductors do have a critical current density in bulk, and it's a rather well-established result, both theoretically and experimentally, that the temperature dependence of that is 1 minus T over Tc to the 3/2. IC0, of course, depends on the parameters. Crudely speaking, as you'd expect, the larger the energy gap, the greater IC0. It's interesting, there's a slightly interesting point about the detailed theory of this. You might think that as I approaches the critical current, the order parameter would go to zero, but that's not in fact the case. It turns out that the order parameter stays finite in this limit. However, the moment you get beyond IC, you get a collapse. It's basically a sort of bistable kind of situation. So you get a jump in the value of psi once you get past the critical current. Okay, so far so good. That's the bare bones of the theory of phase slips in Josephson junctions, etc., in the absence of any kinds of fluctuation and so forth. So it's basically a sort of semi-classical Newtonian type of theory, if you like. Okay, so let's go on and talk a bit about more complicated theory, if you like. Now, there's one idea which in some sense is rather closely tied to what I've just been saying about semi-classical or Newtonian Josephson junctions. And this is the idea of phase slip centers. This is basically introduced in this rather classic paper of Scotch, Pollard et al. In 74, SBT. And basically, it says, well, look, even if I've got what looks like a relatively homogeneous nanowire, there may nevertheless they're liable to be regions where it might be thinner than normal and so forth. And one can think of these as like small microbridges, possibly, or like small simple Josephson junctions. In other words, there are going to be these weak points at which the critical current is more easily exceeded than elsewhere. And so what you'd expect is that these points will behave at least qualitatively like Josephson junctions. Now, they might behave like hysteretic junctions, they might behave as non-hysteretic ones, that'll depend on the detailed parameters. But they're going to behave qualitatively like those. if we have a one of the famous experiments on the original simple Joseph's injunctions is the observation of so-called Shapiro steps. This means steps in the current or blips in the current as a function of the frequency of applied radiation. So you apply microwave radiation of frequency omega to the current, you apply a voltage across, and then when the frequency gets synchronized with the voltage in this way, which remember is basically the second Josephson relation, then you find that you get these blips in the current and so forth. And these were seen in simple Josephson junctions long ago, and they do form a basis for the use in metrology. They have also been seen in many nanowires, in homogeneous nanowires. And so it's believed these phase slip centers are for real and are acting at least qualitatively like Josephson junctions. Now, the theory is in fact quite complicated in detail, and I won't attempt to go into it because it does require quite a bit of microscopic BCS theory and so forth. But crudely speaking, what happens is, or at least according to SBT, and it seems consistent with experiment, the wires essentially turn normal over a distance which they call the quantum diffusion length, which is basically the inelastic diffusion length here. And usually, for most superconductors, this is going to be large compared to the... as a matter of fact, nowadays it's not necessarily large. In the very amorphous materials, it's probably not large compared to the pair radius. But in the systems which SBT were originally considering way back in the 70s, that was certainly the case. So the wire is turned normal over this length. And crudely speaking, you then find what you might expect intuitively, that the effective resistance of this phase slip center is of the order of, what you would calculate for the a bit of wire, which was a bit of normal wire, which was of this length. So rho lambda divided by A, okay, the standard ohmic formula. Now, one of the things you have to bear in mind when you're thinking about the possibility of interpreting the data in terms of these phase slip centers is that unless the distance between these phase slip centers is less than this length, and that's fairly that's a fairly strong condition in practice. If that's not true, then the bulk of the nanowire is still going to remain in the superconducting state. And so, for example, if you're worried about the effects of heating and so forth, that's an important consideration. Okay, it has this idea of phase slip centers, and certainly it seems to explain some of the data, but it doesn't appear to be a complete explanation for all sorts of reasons. The most obvious reason being that at least nowadays, people think their wires are sufficiently homogeneous that there really aren't these constrictions around. So now let's talk about something a rather nice idea, which has been around for quite some time, which has to do with thermal activation. You remember, we thought of this, of our phase, as like a particle which is sitting trapped in the washable potential. Well, at non-zero temperature, it's going to be in contact with a thermal bath, and there's going to be a possibility of the standard Arrhenius-Kramers activation over this barrier. And, there's a rather well-developed theory of Arrhenius-Kramers activation, and universally you find that just about any theory gives you an escape rate which is proportional to something which is at least related to the attempt frequency here. It may not be actually equal to it, but it's related to that. At least it's not particularly sensitive to the height of the barrier as such. It may contain a factor of that, but the point is that the main factor here is going to be the exponential factor, right? This is the standard Gibbs Arrhenius-Kramers expression, the height of the free energy barrier divided by the thermal energy. Okay? That universally comes in just about any theory. Theories of the prefactor may be a bit more complicated, a bit more different. The prefactor does turn out, and this is, how many of you incidentally have read Kramer's 1941 paper on this subject? I would strongly recommend it. It's one of the most beautiful papers, I think, in 20th century physics, this detailed theory of thermal activation. It's basically, at least in the context of classical physics, it's really hasn't been superseded in the 70 years since it was published. It's a really beautiful paper. One could now try to apply this formula in more detail, and you find that for I close to the critical current, that is near what we call the lability point, the lability point is simply the point at which the free energy barrier disappears, so that the particle can now move freely down the washboard. Near that point, it turns out that a very standard calculation which tells you that the free energy barrier behaves as 1 minus I over IC to the 3 halves here. And now what does that mean? Well, typically what's done in many of these experiments on Josephson junctions is that you simply apply a bias current and gradually increase its magnitude until you get close to or hit the critical current. So what that means is if you have a constant sweep rate of your current, there will be a distribution of values of I at which the escape occurs, because it's a random statistical process. So what you can do is to plot a histogram of the number or the frequency of escapes at a particular value of the biasing current below but close to the critical current. Now, there's a rather simple argument which tells you that since both the center and the width of the distribution are determined by this free energy barrier relative to KT, and the free energy barrier was proportional to, remember, to 1 minus I over IC to the 3 halves power, a rather sort of dimensional hand-waving argument will tell you that both the width and the shift of the distribution, in particular the width, which is easier to measure, is proportional. I don't know if you read that. That's supposed to be 2/3, T to the 2/3 power there. And that's the signature of simple thermal activation. That behavior is actually rather nicely seen in many experiments on simple Josephson junctions. So you simply plot the, you do a log-log plot of delta sigma against T, and you do indeed find a nice straight line with a slope of 2/3. The theory does appear to be working rather well in that respect. Now, what happens when the system actually escapes? Well, that does tend to depend rather substantially on the value of the Q factor, remember this combination of factors. If Q is much greater than 1, then once the system has escaped, it'll start running down like mad, and it'll eventually be limited by the terminal velocity, and that will eventually, what that gives you is that the final voltage is just about equal to the classical value, resistance, this should actually be an I, not an IC, in fact. You recover Ohm's law in that element. But for Q less than 1, it simply gets retrapped in the next well, and then the behavior is rather more complicated. All this behavior does seem to be seen relatively reliably in experiment on these simple Josephson junctions. Now, suppose we just go away now for a few minutes from the simple Josephson junctions and turn to a quasi-bulk ring. By quasi-bulk, I mean that its dimensions are large compared to, say, the London penetration depth or the pair radius. This is not the nanowire situation that we're primarily considering, but it's still an interesting question. You remember the reason, which I've given several times by now, I think, for the metastability of the supercurrent. Crudely speaking, you have an order parameter which has a magnitude and a phase. And you can think of the phase as like a string which is round a hoop and so forth. Tie the ends back together, because it's got to be single-valued. Then you find that you have a so-called winding number, which is the number of turns I make around, going once around the loop. And that's a conserved quantity. As long as I don't break the string or cut the hoop, that has to be conserved. So the transcribing that into the language of the order parameter, unless the order parameter goes to 0 across some cross-section, or find some more fancy way to get rid of the topological constraint, then to lose 2 pi of phase, you've, sorry, I think it was something gone wrong with the wording here. Unless, yeah, I think what I meant to say is that it's conserved unless psi goes to zero. So in other words, to lose 2 pi of phase, you have to have psi going to zero according to across the cross-section of the wire. It turns out that, okay, I've actually indicated here that I'm talking about d less than psi, so it is actually back to the nanowire situation in a sense. In this situation where d is much less than psi, it turns out there's nothing more sophisticated the system can do than just turning itself normal over a length of the order of psi. And the free energy which you need for this is given by the bulk condensation energy times the volume over which you've got to turn it normal, which is just xi times A. And the condensation energy goes as 1 minus T over Tc squared. The healing length goes as 1 minus T over Tc to the minus a half. So there is a slight, I'm afraid I've made a slight notational confusion here. This length here is not the pair radius, it's the temperature dependent Ginzburg-Landau healing length, which does have a strong temperature dependence near Tc, and that is quite important. So anyway, the result is that delta F turns out to be proportional to 1 minus T over Tc to the 3 halves. These 3 halves power all seems to come back in all the time in these phenomena. So applying now a standard Kramers Arrhenius formula, have some prefactor, which we don't usually have to be concerned about in great detail, multiplied by this exponential factor here. The phase slip, one thing that you have to remember is that the phase slip can occur in either direction. However, the free energy barrier for it to occur downwards, as it were, so as to reduce the number of turns, is somewhat less than the free energy barrier for it to go upwards. So these two are not exactly in balance. So you work out, using this formula, you can work out the average rate of change of the winding number in. By the Josephson relation, you can define the average voltage as proportional to that. And having put in all the factors which I've left out here, what you find is a formula for the resistance of this quasi-bulk wire, which has some prefactor here. Then the important factor is, again, the exponential. And this is the so-called LAMH formula, LAMH standing for Langer and Abogarkar, who first worked out the exponent, and McCumber and Halperin, who did the prefactor problem. And it turns out, and not obviously, but it turns out that in the dirty limit, which is usually the case for what we're interested in, the constant is given by this simple formula here. The interesting point about this is that basically, you know all the numbers in this constant independently. Xi of zero, now that is the zero temperature value of the healing length, which apart from a factor is just the zero temperature pair radius. That's something which you believe you know for any reasonable bulk three-dimensional superconductor. L is just the length of the wire. Rq is the quantum unit of resistance, and Rn is the absolute resistance, a normal resistance of the wire. So basically, there's no freedom in fitting this formula. You know everything that should go into it. And you can actually try to compare this formula with the experimental data. And lo and behold, for many nanowires, that does seem to work over as much as 11 orders of magnitude sometimes. So in other words, these are typically wires which show the superconducting type behavior. Let me just go back to that for a moment. The appropriate graph. Yeah. Okay. So typically the LAMH behavior is this behavior here. Right? The resistance is dropping out of sight as I go down to low temperatures, because basically thermal activation is no longer effective. So far so good. Let's see. Yeah, okay, before I go on, let me just stop for a moment and ask if there are any questions about that. So it's a rather well worked out theory. Abogarkar and Langer first wrote it down in the mid 70s, I guess, and there's been a lot of theoretical refinements and experimental measurements since. That, at least in for certain cases, for relatively thick but a short superconducting wires, that does appear right now, at least, to be the whole story. Of course, when we say the whole story, we mean the whole story insofar as we can actually do the experiments. And since we can't do the experiments down to zero temperature, that's, of course, a restriction. Apart from that, it seems to work. Okay. We know that if we have some, rather generally, if we have some kind of barrier activation process, then at sufficiently high temperatures, it'll be described by rather well by some kind of thermal activation formula. But we might expect that if we go down to low enough temperatures, the thermal activation will be frozen out. And then we might ask, well, is it possible to have a different kind of escape, namely quantum tunneling through the barrier? And this has been the subject over the last 30 years or so of considerable amount of action, both theoretically and experimentally. Let's take our standard Josephson junction. Let's assume that we can use the washboard potential Hamiltonian. And now, let's simply make the, let's go back to the analogy with a mechanical particle, right? Well, for a mechanical particle, you know that, sure enough, at high enough temperatures, we have thermal activation over the barrier. For low enough temperatures, we have quantum tunneling through the barrier, and we use the standard WKB formulae to calculate the tunneling. Can we do the same here? Well, to do so, we'd have to assume that we can take our semi-classical equations of motion, which, remember, we wrote down for our Josephson junction, and we can simply quantize them by the canonical technique. That is, we define a canonical momentum. In the classical case, we then interpret that in quantum mechanics as minus I h bar d by dx, etc., and out drops a Schrodinger equation for us. Now, question, is that valid in this case here? Well, we did this way back in 1980 or so, and we got a lot of flak for doing it. And one of the interesting objections, which was raised at the time, was put in I think it was David Merman who put it in this concise form. He says, look, you've simply got this classical equation, and you are, you're going to just sort of turn the handle and apply the standard canonical quantization technique. Okay, how far can you push that? Can you quantize the equations of mathematical economics? I think it's an interesting question. Well, not obviously. I think the answer is not obviously, and not obviously in this case either, in fact. You are talking, and one of the objections that was made was that we are taking a semi-classical equation, which, however, referred to something which was itself intrinsically quantum mechanical, namely the phase of the Cooper pair wave function. That's the phase of a wave function is intrinsically already a quantum mechanical idea. Can you now, as it were, re-quantize that? Okay. Not obvious at all. But, I wrote a long justification of that, which is in the Proceedings of the Lesouch of the 75 Lesouch Summer School, I guess. 85 Lesouch Summer School. It's not trivial, but you can do it. Most people simply assume you can do it, and so most of the literature does now take this for granted. There are alternative ways also of trying to justify it, for example, by using a path integral techniques and so forth. Anyway, so let's assume we've done that. We do have to be rather careful about one point. In talking about this so-called macroscopic quantum tunneling phenomenon, that is the escape from a metastable well, we're always implicitly making the assumption that once the system has got out, there's sufficient dissipation around, as it were, that it never has any chance of coming back and interfering constructively with itself. And that's not obvious for very small currents, and we'll come back to that point, in fact. And let's make that assumption. Then we find, we can just apply the standard, at least at first sight we can apply, the standard WKB formulae. again, you have a prefactor here, which is not that trivial to calculate, but it's of the order of the attempt frequency. Has the typical exponential minus b over h bar. And for a system close to the lability point, this is actually a rather general result, it turns out you can express this WKB exponent in terms of the barrier height and the small oscillation frequency here. And this is a typical numerical factor which comes out for this specifically when you're close to lability. And this is close to but not equal to 2 pi. Now, since delta u is proportional to, as we previously said, 1 minus I over IC to the 3 halves, omega 0 is proportional to that to the quarter. And therefore, you predict that as a function of the current in the quantum tunneling-dominated regime, the log of the escape rate, and therefore the log of the resistance, should be proportional to 1 minus I over IC to the 5 quarters power. Unfortunately, the difference between this 5 quarters power and a 3 halves power is really not too easy to sort out experimentally, as you can imagine. However, what this does say, unambiguously, is since there's no reference to temperature in this formula, then you would expect that the width of the escape histograms should go to a constant as temperature goes to zero. And you should, in fact, expect the crossover to occur, crudely speaking, when KT is of the order of h bar omega 0 over 2 pi, not h bar omega 0 itself. I say the 2 pi is not exact. It's basically this factor here. These experiments along these lines were first done in the early 80s, and so indeed, sure enough, people saw that at high temperatures, if you plotted delta sigma, the width of the escape histograms, as a function of temperature, then sure enough, at high temperatures it went as t to the 2/3, and then at low temperatures it flattened off. And you might have, you might think, well, everyone would jump up and down saying, ha ha, we have seen quantum tunneling. Not so. Everyone started objecting that maybe what you were seeing was some kind of flattening off of your effective noise temperature. Okay? Everyone knows that this kind of experiment is complicated. You have all sorts of amplifiers floating around. They inject reverse noise, et cetera, et cetera. And so it wasn't really sorted out until the experiments of John Clark and his co-workers in the mid-80s, where what they were able to do was to actually change the parameters in such a way as to change the expected crossover point. And they found, sure enough, things did appear to behave exactly like that. And it seemed extremely difficult to believe that just by changing the parameters, you've changed the effective noise temperature in just the way to make that work. So at least everything does seem to be consistent with this theory working. Now, an interesting question okay, so far so good, but you've just done a simple WKB calculation. What about the effects of of dissipation? Well, remember that dissipation in the case of a simple Josephson junction is usually due to the shunting conductance. So it goes as the shunting conductance. And the result which seems to come out is that at least for this simple model which we're discussing, which is basically exactly analogous to that of a mechanical particle subject to linear friction, okay, so nothing more sophisticated than that. For this simple model, at least, it does seem to be the case that the effect of dissipation is to increase the WKB exponent and thereby suppress the tunneling. Remember that in thermal activation, the dissipation affects only the prefactor. So really, Kramer's activation rate is not terribly sensitive to dissipation. In the case of quantum tunneling, it affects the exponent and not just the prefactor. Now, I think there's a rather interesting way of visualizing what's going on there. Imagine that you supply your dissipation by coupling your system to some kind of complex oscillator bath or some other degree of freedom, and so forth. This is the standard way of treating it, typically. Then you can think of the problem in a many-dimensional space. So you're now tunneling in this many-dimensional space. And it turns out that the effect of the dissipation means that you've still got a saddle point. You've got to go over a free energy barrier, so there has to be a saddle point somewhere in the space. However, the saddle point no longer lies on the the original axis, as it were. It's been shifted off into the somewhere into the plane. The height of the barrier, this is a tricky point, I won't try to go into the technical details, but the height of the barrier is unchanged by the dissipation. However, the distance you've got to go in the many particle space, in the many coordinate space, many dimensional space, to get there is longer. Now you remember that in classical physics, when you're talking about Cramer's activation, the Cramer's exponent only contains the height of the barrier. Doesn't matter how long it took you to get to the top of the barrier, it's just the height of the barrier which is counting. So it's natural then that dissipation doesn't affect that exponent. However, in the quantum case, the WKB exponent is not just sensitive to the height of the barrier, it depends also on how far you had to travel to get there. And this distance has now been increased. So you would expect that it would affect the exponent, and indeed it does. Okay, now rather closely associated with this, with the phenomenon of quantum tunneling, something which is actually slightly different, in fact, and at first sight rather difficult to visualize. This is the phenomenon, the theoretically predicted phenomenon of the so-called Schmidt-Bogdanov transition. Suppose that we've actually got no bias current on at all for the moment. Or we've got a very, very tiny current, but essentially no current. Okay, under these conditions, assuming that these states can indeed be counted as different, and that is an assumption which we have to watch, but assuming they can be counted as different, then you might expect that you get a coherent process in which the system moves from here to here and then on to here, and so forth. In fact, you might expect that you'd form some kind of block wave kind of state, kind of band here. Well, Now you can ask the question, okay, that's the case. You can work out exactly what happens in this model for in the absence of dissipation. What's the effect of dissipation? Well, if your dissipation is ohmic, the model we've been considering does assume ohmic dissipation, it turns out there's a critical value of the dissipation which localizes the particle in a single well. That is, once you place it here, it stays there, and the dissipation prevents it tunneling coherently across there. Again, that's by now, this is in some sense a classic problem in statistical physics and has now been the subject of numerous papers. And so that does seem to be right. Now, what interesting question, for a simple Josephson junction, at what value of the dissipation, that is of the resistance, the shunting resistance, would you expect this transition to occur? And the answer is, believe it or not, exactly at the quantum unit of resistance, h over 4e squared, is 6.5 kilo-ohms. And so the qualitative picture is that for r greater than the quantum unit of resistance, there are many phase slips. So in other words, the phase across your junction is not conserved, as it were. And that corresponds to, maybe this isn't immediately obvious, but I think it'll become a little more obvious when we do it for wires. That means you've got insulating behavior, whereas for R less than RQ, there are no phase slips occurring, and the system basically behaves just like the original Josephson model. In other words, it's still superconducting. So you'd expect then a superconducting insulating transition when R crosses the value RQ. Now, there have been some experiments on that. There was an earlier experiment which did look at for and claim to see that phenomenon in a simple junction. But I think the most convincing evidence is from an array of Josephson junctions in this paper here, where they did seem to get a rather definite transition in behavior at this point. It's still, I would say, the evidence is still not 100% convincing. But everything appears to be consistent with this happening, at least. Okay, now we come to what is really, in some sense, the meatiest bit of this problem, and the one I have to say where I'm not entirely satisfied that A, the existing literature is right, and B, even if it is right, that I understand it. So there's a certain amount of uncertainty, I think, here. Suppose we have a nanowire. Let's suppose for the moment it's completely homogeneous nanowire, so there are no phase slip centers or anything like that. Then basically, I know what happens in the classical regime. I have this Langer-Ambergarka picture, which does seem to work pretty well. What happens, is there an analog of the quantum activation in simple Josephson junctions? Well, yes, there really should be. You've now got you've got a field where initially you've got a state where you've got a 2 pi kink, say, in the phase of your order parameter, and you want to go through some kind of process which will land you up with a zero phase drop. In other words, you want to lose 1 2 pi worth of phase. Of course, in real life, it's much more likely you start with n plus 1 and end up with n. But let's just for the moment consider that you start off with one of a phase drop of exactly 2 pi and you want to get to zero. Now, as I say, we know that there is some kind of rather complicated phase space in which the which you can plot the energy as a function of the functional of the order parameter field. And of course, classically, that's just the Langer and Bagalka picture. But now, we want to actually consider the problem of the tunneling of the order parameter field out of its metastable state into a more stable state. And this is actually, of course, a special case of a problem which is of much more general interest. A famous, famous example of such a problem in cosmology is the idea that somehow at the birth of the universe the quantum fields which describe the various elementary particles we know about might have settled themselves into some kind of vacuum, which is however not the most stable case. In other words, you have some kind of metastable vacuum there, and then the question is presumably at high enough temperatures you could thermally activate out of that vacuum, but suppose that you're not at those high temperatures, could you quantum tunnel out of that vacuum? And this is a matter I should remind you of some practical importance, because if indeed we are sitting in this false vacuum, and just it should happen at say 10:15 this morning that we get a quantum tunneling event out of it, well, we're not going to know what's happened to us, basically, presumably. So you know, this is something which obviously has attracted a certain amount of attention in particle physics and cosmology, and people have got quite sophisticated treating this. So let's just try to visualize what's happening. If our wire was larger, then there would be a possibility, if it were thicker, as thick compared to the London penetration depth, say, then, of course, we, as you all know, we get the possibility of real vortices, that is, situations in which if we just plot just take a particular plane and plot the order parameter, then it behaves qualitatively like in this picture here, okay? Where in that case, this will just be the x-axis and the y-axis, nothing fancy, okay? So we certainly know that kind of configuration is possible. Now, we can think of the tunneling process as in some sense represented by a vortex in imaginary time. This is, I think, not a terribly intuitive idea, but remember that there is this rather fashionable way of thinking about quantum tunneling processes as involving trajectories in imaginary time. If you're willing to accept that idea, then you can think of this rather more complicated process in those terms. Actually, I think my tour is running the wrong way here. So I start with delta phi, a phase drop of 2 pi across here. And now, as a function of imaginary time, as it were, I introduce this vortex until, at the end of the game, I've got a delta phi equals 0 across there. So as I say, at this moment, may not be a helpful way of looking at things. But what we do expect is that, on rather general grounds, the slip rate would be given by some kind of WKB type formula. And the WKB exponent, which is presumably going to be the main factor, is given by a formula crudely of this type. You have some effective mass, some effective potential, all to the half, integrated over the appropriate trajectory divided by h bar. Okay, well, that's not much use until we actually know what these what the parameters which occur in here actually are. So let's see whether we can say anything about that. Well, let's first of all try to do a naive, sort of very naive argument. if, for the moment, let's ignore the core of the vortex. Crudely speaking, if we just go back for a moment, when we're considering, whether we're considering the actual energy of a real vortex in ordinary three-dimensional space, or whether we're considering this quantum tunneling process, it's convenient to distinguish between the regions far out, that's far beyond the appropriate healing length, where basically you've just got a bulk order parameter with a certain phase gradient. In other words, you've got ordinary hydrodynamic flow out there. So these are what I call the hydrodynamic region. And then you have the core region where, the, crudely speaking, you've turned the metal normal. So for the moment, let's just focus on the hydrodynamic region outside and see whether we can make any useful statements there. Well, very crudely, what you'd expect is that the effective potential energy which comes in is of the order of the classical free energy necessary to create your vortex-like structure. Well, that was just what occurred in the Langer-Amberger formula. That's just the bulk condensation energy times the volume involved, which is A times I. What about the effective mass? Well, prima facie, you might wave your hands and say, well, that's the total mass of the condensate in the length xi of the wire, rho A xi. Finally, what about the integral ds? That's the characteristic time of the phase slip, which is presumably of the same order as the attempt frequency, times the characteristic velocity. Now, you have to think a little about what the characteristic velocity would be for this case. And the only plausible velocity which comes in is the critical velocity, which is h over m xi. So putting those together, what you find is that an order of magnitude estimate of your WKB exponent here is this here. However, it turns out, and this is not an accident, that rho times the critical velocity squared is just of the order of the condensation energy. After all, remember that the critical velocity for a bulk superconductor is simply the value of the velocity at which the flow energy becomes equal to the condensation energy. So this does work out. And so the this expression, I should have put the brackets on here, this is exactly the same as this. So in fact, we find this whole square root is just the F condensation times A times xi, which is the classical free energy barrier. So in other words, the WKB exponent, perhaps not totally surprisingly, is the classical free energy barrier divided by h bar omega zero. Omega zero, however, the attempt frequency, that's not quite so obvious. It turns out to be this quantity here, which you can work out is actually of the order of the condensation energy divided by n. So actually, if you now put these together, you find two things. First of all, you expect the quantum activation to dominate at low enough temperatures. But in fact, this is not correct. H bar omega zero is right, but this is not in general correct that T is much less than TC. You have to be a little more careful than that and relate it to the effective condensation energy there. More interestingly, in absolute terms, using this and this, you find that B is simply of the order of the number of electrons in a healing length of the wire. So forth. Therefore, it clearly depends strongly on things like the wire thickness and so on and so forth. So that's sort of a zeroth order attempt to get the tunneling exponent. Alas, it turns out life is more complicated than that, considerably more complicated. The effective mass. What do we mean by the effective mass? Well, it's simply the second derivative of the energy with respect to the superfluid velocity. But in a charged system, in general, that free energy will contain not just the kinetic energy, but also some kind of inductance energy. And for quite generally for a wire, it turns out the ratio of the inductance to the kinetic energy is A over lambda squared. So in thick wires, that is wires with D of the order of lambda L or greater, the energy of the vortex is going to be dominated not by the kinetic energy, that is the kinetic inductance, but by the real electromagnetic inductance. Well, so far so good, but that doesn't really completely solve the problem, because once I get to values thick enough for this effect to be important, probably the process of phase slip is itself not homogeneous in space. So we have to do a more complicated calculation. One of the first attempts to do this was by my former student, Jim Nduan, way back in 1995. And he found an interesting result. He found that, and this is basically had to do with the fact that as the electrons, or as the current or whatever, the order parameter, as it tries to tunnel, that involves motion of charges and currents, electric charges and electric currents, that then induces fields, not just in the wire itself, but also in the three-dimensional space surrounding the wire. Okay? And he did a calculation which suggested a very interesting result, that as a consequence of this extra, if you like, the extra inertia associated with the electromagnetic field, the value of the WKB exponent would be precisely of the order of the inverse of the fine structure constant. Now, of course, as you know, the fine structure constant is roughly 1/137, so that means the B is of the order of 10 to the 2, which would mean that for any reasonable attempt rate, quantum tunneling would be quite impossible to see in practice. Now, more recently, Zykin and co-workers have come back and spent a considerable amount of time on this problem, and they've considered not only the case where D is large compared to lambda, which was the relevant one when Duan did his work in the mid-90s, but no longer is the most relevant one. And he actually came out with a more optimistic estimate. As far as I can see, now this is a point at which I have to confess I'm not entirely clear exactly where the difference comes from, but it looks as if what's happening here is that on very general grounds, you can write down a form of the Lagrangian or Hamiltonian, which involves, first of all, a capacitance, some capacitance times the, delta phi dot squared. That's your kinetic energy term, basically. And then a term involving an inductance, which is something like L times I. I is proportional to grad phi squared. So your Lagrangian is of the order of that integrated over appropriate space and time. And now, almost hand-wavingly, on general grounds, you can extract the fact that you expect your WKB exponent to be proportional to the square root of, I haven't got this the right way up, L divided by C. So some kind of effective impedance here. Now, what Duan's calculation essentially did, in effect, was to put in the impedance of free space. What Zykin and company have done is to substitute for that the impedance, the actual impedance of unit length of the wire. And it was not necessarily the same. And in general, may give you, for small wires, may give you a much smaller exponent. Anyway, the putting the details aside, the outcome, the net outcome of the considerations of Zykin and co-workers is that, in fact, the situation isn't as bad as Duan calculated, that there is a reasonable probability of seeing these quantum phase slips in very narrow wires. So try to sum up. On the theory side, you expect that at there are several different phenomena which may be relevant here. First of all, you expect that for inhomogeneous wires, you may get phase slip centers and so forth, and they may dominate the behavior. And this is likely to happen in inhomogeneous wires or very long wires simply because the probability of getting a phase slip center is greater there. Apart from that, you expect that any non-zero resistivity will be due to bulk phase slips, well, that is phase slips different from not occurring at phase slip centers. And there are several mechanisms for that. There's the Langer-Amberger mechanism, the by Kramer's activation, and there's the quantum tunneling phenomenon at lower temperatures. In addition, you've got to remember that at least for sufficiently small bias currents, you may get, or at least theoretically, you may get this Bugendorf-Schmidt transition. So how does that match up to an experiment? Well, it's probably fair to say that if you take, because it focuses on not very thin nanowires, down to the very lowest T that we can currently go to experimentally, essentially the LAMH mechanism, that is the classical thermal phase slip mechanism, is plausibly the whole story. Okay, that is, it can explain just about all the data. I have to say, there is a problem very close to TC, where it looks as if LAMH does not give quantitatively the right answer. But in some sense, that's a very, very small part of the whole curve. It's only one out of your 11 orders of magnitude, so I think that's really not so important. For very thin and short wires, it looks like you may have to supplement the data by quantum phase slips at low temperatures, and that may then explain the so-called normal state, normal date data, but certainly it may explain, it's qualitatively consistent with Schmidt-Bugadiev transition, a superconductor insulator transition, at a value of Rn close to Rq. That does seem to be qualitatively at least coming out of the data. For inhomogeneous wires or longer wires, phase slip centers may dominate. Again, the longer your wire, almost certainly the more important heating effects are. So that's, again, a complication which is not always taken into account. So that's not, as I emphasized earlier, that's not the whole story, but at least it gives you some kind of qualitative feeling for what's going on and the sort of major theoretical considerations which have come in. I should say there are all sorts of, there are some new, very, in some cases, very new data. One particularly interesting claim is the claim by Astafiev et al., in a very recent issue of Nature, to have seen coherent quantum phase slips. That is, the phase slips which allegedly occur on the superconducting side of the Schmidt-Bugadiev transition. If that's true, it's extremely interesting because it means that there have been some theoretical proposals to use these nanowires as qubits, and that's only going to work if you can actually get coherent. If you've got at least two different states, and you can get coherent transition processes between them. And the claim is that by this group that they've actually seen evidence of such things, but I think that's so recent that it's still somewhat up in the air. Okay, so as I said, not a complete story, but hopefully some of the main ideas. If you look back on the history of attempts to see macroscopic, what you might call macroscopic quantum behavior in things like superconducting qubits and so forth, you'll find that there's been an awful lot of skepticism about it. I mean, it's difficult to remember this now. I mean, any of you who got into the field of quantum information later than 2000 probably will be totally unaware of this. But right up, quite literally, right up to 1999, there were quite sort of respectable and well-respected theorists who were claiming that this whole business of trying to use superconducting qubits for quantum information processes was sort of totally misguided, just a waste of the taxpayers' money, in effect. And the sort of reasons they gave were always these what I call electron on Sirius arguments. They always went something like this: you know, you've got this system which you agree is sort of reasonably macroscopic. If it's reasonably macroscopic, it has lots and lots of degrees of freedom, so its energy levels are incredibly closely spaced and so forth. And therefore, the tiniest perturbation, like the motion of a single electron or a distant star, is going to be enough to screw up the phase coherence between these. That argument is actually complete rubbish in retrospect. it's actually complete rubbish for some boring reasons and some interesting ones. The boring reason is that very often you're not interested in all the degrees of freedom. You're only interested in one particular one, say the center of mass degree of freedom. So the fact that you've got all these others around is irrelevant so long as they're not coupling to it in a way which gives rise to a strong degree of decoherence. The second point I think is more interesting, that in fact, your principal degree of freedom almost certainly is coupling to the other degrees of freedom, very often coupling quite strongly, but it doesn't matter. Think of the example, I might have given you this example before, but it doesn't hurt to give it again. Think about the neutron interferometer. simple argument that the neutron interferometer should not work. Why? Well, got these two neutron beams, they've gone off to maybe a few tens of centimetres apart, as it were. The textbook description is that you have a coherent superposition of a state here and a state here. Well, that's nonsense. You don't have a coherent superposition. Why not? Because, well, the electron has a magnetic moment. It's interacting with the electromagnetic field, and it's interacting differently depending on whether the neutron is here or here. So the states of the... Now, of course, this depends in detail on how you treat the high-energy cutoffs and so forth, but crudely speaking, the state of the electromagnetic vacuum is different when the neutron is here and when it's here. The neutron is entangled with the black body radiation field. Who cares? I mean, no experimentalist ever cares about that, right? Why not? Well, the crude picture is that, okay, as the neutron beam splits, as it were, the state of the electromagnetic vacuum gets entangled with it, and so something similarly splits. Neutron then comes back together again. Back comes the electromagnetic vacuum. So at the end of the day, it doesn't matter. In other words, you've got an adiabatic coupling to the to all these other degrees of freedom, to your environment, as it were. And so long as you don't have any real radiation processes, that completely doesn't matter. The moment, of course, you start to radiate real photons, then that's another kettle of fish. But luckily, the neutron is only doing that with incredibly tiny amplitude. But it was this, you know, this kind of argument. I mean, or rather the failure to appreciate this argument, which had led so many people before 2000 to say that all of this is sort of complete nonsense. And then, of course, Jonathan and others showed us this for real.